daughters and sons of Africa. Our names are DJ Dash, age 10,
and Xavier, age 13.
In the tradition of genuine African resistance, we want to share something special with the masses of our people at home and abroad. Today, June 29th, marks the 78th birthday of one of our boldest and bravest warriors, Kwame Ture, formerly known as Stokely Carmichael. As many of you know, Brother Kwame transitioned on November 15th, 1998, from prostate cancer. We pay homage to Brother Kwame through this mixtape, which blends African music and Brother Kwame's powerful voice and words.
We will journey the struggle that began in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, Lowndes County Freedom Organization, the First Black Panther Party, the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, Students of Black Unity, All African People's Revolutionary Party, and finally, the Democratic Party of Guinea. As a comrade and brother would say, organize, 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 and of course the slogan of the Democratic Party of Guinea, ready for the revolution. As we will soon be young adults, we want to introduce our peers to Brother Kwame, the same way he introduced his generation to the works of Osadiafo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, and Ahmed Sekou Touré. We hope this mixtape makes Mother Africa and her scattered children proud.
Now I have a few minutes, only five, so if you'll allow me, maybe I can say a number of things that needs to be said in this country. That needs to be said in this country. And that's what I want to talk about. Now I want to talk to black people across this country. I want to talk to black people across this country. There are four things we have to do. Number one, we have to stop being ashamed of being black. We've got to stop being ashamed of being black. Number two, we have to move into a position where we can define terms for what we want them to be, not what racist white society wants it to be. We have to move to define. We have to move to a position where we can feel strength and unity amongst each other, from Watts to Harlem, where we won't ever be afraid. And the last thing we have to do is to build a power base so strong in this country that will bring them to their knees every time they mess with us.
Students, of course, have a role in any society, capitalist society, social society. And their role is to institutionalize the values of the given society. Because, of course, in a capitalist system, this should be done unconsciously. But students are the spark of revolution. Of course, we make a difference here between revolution and reform. Those who want reform seek to work, I guess, from the top down. Those of us who understand fundamental changes know it must come from the bottom up. The students, of course, always work at the point of ideas in a society. Their job is to acquire knowledge, and of course, this knowledge which they acquired is geared by an ideology which tells them what to do with it. So if you're a doctor, instead of curing cancer, you should turn a man to a woman to get money, even though she can't make babies. That was life. Students, we say, at the point of ideas, at the point of values. When one speaks of revolution, one speaks of overturning the values of a given society. If one is not speaking of overturning the values, then one speaks of reform. Thus, one can join the Democratic Party. We're not here to overturn its value. But certainly if one is here for revolution and one is here for people's liberation, one would know that a corrupt instrument can never lead a people to liberation. At all. Students then, we say, come to question the values of a society. Of course, in relationship to the values, students, just like anyone in a society, have but two alternatives. Either they accept the values or they reject the values. It's as simple as that. Of course, if they reject the values, they have a responsibility to find alternative values. But either you accept cheating as a student or you reject it. It's as simple as that. Either you accept any value in a society or you reject it. Students, once having rejected a society, bringing together their ideas and their energies and strength to work against these values, connected with the masses, always give us revolution. Thus, from the 60s, while a reform movement, we were able to see that students, joined with the masses of the people, came to bring a lot of changes to the country. Thus, we must not confuse ourselves. The job of students is clear here. Their job is to spark revolution. Students cannot carry revolution through to the end. The final triumph of revolution must be carried through to the end by the masses, the workers, and the peasants. But students play a crucial role. We say they spark revolution. Certainly, if we did not recognize this, the enemy did. The FBI before the 60s did not have informers on college campus. After the 60s, they put an informer on every college campus in the country. Their job was simple: stop any activity at all that runs against the status quo. We say it's a mobilized people who can allow this, because when you mobilize and fight like an animal, after you get tired and you wind down, then the enemy comes back stronger than he did before. Students spark revolution, and we must work everywhere to have students live up to their responsibility of sparking revolution. Here, of course, it calls for the students properly understanding the role of knowledge. Knowledge has but one purpose. Its purpose is to alleviate the sufferings of humanity. Knowledge has but one purpose. Knowledge has but one purpose. Its purpose is to alleviate the sufferings of humanity. Capitalism is a backward and stupid system. Capitalism is a contemptuous system. Capitalism is a system based on profit. It will make a commodity out of everything. It will take my mother and sell her on a slave block. It will make students acquire knowledge and make them sell their knowledge on the slave block to advance themselves rather than serving humanity. The struggle becomes especially crucial for African students. We say no individual African in this country makes any advance unless it is a result as mass struggle. Any student sitting in any seat in any college in America know that they didn't gain that seat through their own individual talents, but only through the struggles of the masses of their people. Thus, that seat belongs to the people. The knowledge they acquire there must be used for the people. Otherwise, they've already betrayed the people and have repeated errors. The 1960s, of course, was a mobilized area, and in a mobilized area, there would be a lot of confusion. One of the biggest areas of confusion was the basis of the struggle. Some felt that the basis of the struggle must be made by appeals to morality. Of course, anyone knowing anything about struggle knows that this cannot be. Even Frederick Douglass so long ago told us that power concedes nothing without demands. It never did, and it certainly never will. Consequently, what was learned from the struggles of the 60s is when one comes to struggle, one must struggle for power, not for morality. Certainly, one cannot speak of morality when one is speaking to capitalism. It is an immoral system. It has no conscience. It knows only its own interest. It will commit genocide to take land from the red man. It will commit slavery to enrich itself. It will drop napalm bombs on babies in Vietnam. Consequently, when we come to talk of advancing ourselves through power, we must come to speak of just that, power. And we must understand that the only place we find power is through the organized masses. Simply put, until the masses of our people are organized, we will remain powerless and thus the victims of all vicious powers that seek to exploit us. The lessons then must be clear. There's no question, and you must in no way lose faith in the masses of the people. It is they and they alone who make revolution, not their petty bourgeois spokesmen who betray them everywhere. And the conditions of the masses are worse today than they were in the 60s. These masses must have changed and will have changed by any means necessary. The final point then, you must not become confused by the American capitalist system, which holds up betrayers of the people's struggle as representatives of the people. In any army in the world, if you desert, you should get shot. It's law. So you must be shot. And if you volunteer for an army, you should be shot twice. You volunteer for the people's army. The people go to fight. They're ready to fight. You say, I'm leaving. What you mean you're leaving? But if you will look at our struggle since the 60s, you will see nothing but betrayals by the petty bourgeois elements in our society. The African bourgeoisie is the most corrupt bourgeoisie in the world. In Africa, they seek luxury in the midst of mass suffering. There are more Mercedes in Africa than in any other continent in the world. In America, as soon as they arrive at a position based on this blood of the people, they snatch that position and run away from the people. But you must not think that they represent the people. They only represent their opportunistic self, using the people every step of the way. So you must not be confused. It must be clear then, for the 60s, the class struggle in the African Revolution must be more ruthless and uncompromising than in any other revolution. Here then, the masses must come without pity and without mercy to trample upon these reactionary pigs who, after the people have gained struggle through their blood, come to hand back the gains on a silver platter to the very enemy the people fought. This will come as a natural consequence. The people themselves are everywhere screaming that it's time for them to deal with these reactionary pigs. Even in America, they say, our leaders must be held accountable. They're only saying here that these people must be accountable to those who made it possible for them to get there. Thus, not only is the revolution inevitable, but it is clarifying itself and it is qualifying itself. For the African masses everywhere, the clairvoyant position now for class struggle has become inevitable and irreversible. The petty bourgeoisie everywhere will be running for cover, but the masses will spare them not. Consequently, we, who have dedicated our lives to the people's struggle, we, who knowing that the people will always be free, we, understanding that we must make a contribution to qualify our struggle since the 60s, have been dedicating all our energies to only one task, the organization of the masses of our people. The organization of the masses of our people. We are not running for mayor. We're not running for president. No changes can come from the top down. We're not stupid. Changes can only come from the bottom up. The masses and the masses alone can make them. If you want to learn something from the 60s, the lesson is simple. Organize the masses of the people. Thank you. Been delayed because of all the work we have to do and because of the tyranny of time. It's a tyrant time. Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah used to whistle all the time. So many beautiful things to do, so little time.
Can I watch you die?
This task which we involved in, the task of conscious raising of the masses of the people, must be properly understood. Each audience which you come before is not the same audience. But our task is raising consciousness. And in some audiences, the level of consciousness is much higher than it is in others. This is a fact. Go to Africans, who've been in America longer than all of them. Go to Africans, who came here under conditions none of them came here under.
All of them volunteered to came here, went to get visas to get here. Look at the Africans who didn't ask to come here, who were brought here against their will, who should hate America and should be the last to blame the Americans. Ask them, what are you? I'm American and proud of it, and if you say something against it, I'll kill you.
Home is where I live inside my white powder dreams. Home was once an empty vacuum that's filled now with my silent screams. Home is where the needle marks tried to heal my broken heart, and it.
They say the job of the enemy is to make you identify totally with the enemy.
Even if we call ourselves Americans, they don't treat us like Americans. They don't treat us like Americans. We have built this country, and they shoot us down in the street like dogs, and somebody's still holding on to them about we Americans, with nothing in America for us except exploitation. There's nothing in America for us except exploitation and oppression.
Yes, this is the ghetto.
Ask any of us, and if you have 1,000 of us in one room and each ask each of us what we are, you'll get 1,000 different answers. Of course, you and the slave know what we speak of. We are forced with the same problem here. The problem is through political persuasion, through constant discussion, using nothing but the truth to let our people know exactly what they are. Africans. Nothing more, nothing less. Nothing more, nothing less. Of course, as we pointed out over and over again, this question of not wanting to be an African is based squarely in ignorance. The enemy keeps us ignorant, not haphazardly, but by calculated plans. Eternal struggle. The capitalist system will confuse you. Miriam McCabe was fond of saying that our people are just the now people. They want everything now. If you tell them something for later, I ain't got no time for later. I want it now. Capitalism makes you think that everything must come now. But the struggle in which you're involved in is a struggle in which you will not reap that which you've sown. You have already reaped that. You've already reaped that which have been sown by past generations. You must sow for future generations to reap. We must come to understand how tied we are to Africa. That can be easily demonstrated quantitatively, not even qualitatively. We have spent at best in America some 500 years. Do you know that woman began in Africa? Do you know how many years you spent in Africa? Before 500, matter of fact, 500 years is less than the drop of a grain of sand in the ocean when compared to African history. And the 500 years that we've spent in America ain't nothing but hell. You must really be confused that you want to give up millions of years of history, millions of years of development, millions of years of movement for 500 years of hell. Right. Africa is our home. Right. Africa is our only salvation. Since we are among conscious fighters, we just want to inspire you. Do not ever get tired of the struggle in which you're involved in. As a matter of fact, a true struggler becomes better every day at what he's doing. Years ago, it would take me a long time to convince a brother or sister of a certain point in the struggle. Now I can do it in 2 minutes, and I'm working to do it in 2 seconds. We must every day perfect ourselves, which we call the instrument of advancement. Every day in every way. What I used to organize and take 2 weeks to do when I was 22 years old, working in Mississippi in the South, today, in any village in Guinea, in West Africa, I must be able to do the same thing in 2 days. It is only this constant progress of we ourselves who are fighters. The fighters sometimes make the mistake of not seeing the necessity for them to perfect themselves as an instrument to help raise the consciousness of our people. If you want somebody to follow something that you are telling them, which is a good advice, the best way to make them follow it is to be the best example of the advice you're giving them.
African Congress, most of Africa, of course, was colonized. Kwame Ture came to change all this. By 1958, he threw the British out of Cape Coast and named it Ghana. And Ture declared before the entire world that the independence of Ghana is meaningless unless it's linked with the entire continent of Africa and its unification and liberty. And Ghana and Ture made Ghana the base for every movement that fought against colonialism. Mugabe, who is now the head of Zimbabwe, where was he trained? In Ghana. Go and ask all of them. Nkrumah set up freedom schools, teaching how to use arms to go and fight. It was Nkrumah who built the base and pushed Pan-Africanism. He understood that Africa was divided in 1865 at the Berlin Conference, and that we cannot accept divisions imposed upon us by our enemy. Africa is one, we must unify her. This has been the task. Of course, since Nkrumah, the movement picked up. The independence of Guinea came in the same 1958, later that year, and with Sekou Touré and Kwame Nkrumah, the movement really coalesced force. The Pan-African movement, of course, was not going to be left alone. Imperialism would seek to divide it. That's their job. Sekou Touré says, if the enemy is not doing anything against you, that's because you're not doing anything. Of course, if Africa, they are looking against the act, it's clear. So their job was to divide. If you look, they divided the Pan-African movement in what was called the Casablanca Bloc and the Monrovia Bloc, the revolutionaries and the reactionaries, to put it in one simple word. Of course, the Casablanca group included the fighting forces in Algeria, the FLN, which the other African states refused to recognize. Of course, Nasser had to be in it. Of course, Nkrumah. Of course, Sekou Touré, Tunisia, of course, Mohammed V in Morocco, who just made serious war to get independence away from the French. The other group was called the Moderate Group, and they were all made up of reactionaries and scalabaris who didn't want African unity and rose a million problems and sabotage it and work for imperialism against the interests of their people, and that still continues today. I always say one of the weaknesses of the African Revolution is that we are the only people who allow our enemies to strut with impunity amongst us. It's only because of our weakness, hunger of our weakness. So socialism is an economic system, and there can only be two in the world, capitalism or socialism. Because every economic system must answer one fundamental question. Who will own and control the wealth of the country?
who will own and control the means of production? The question can only be answered two ways. Either a few will own, or everyone will own. It's as simple as that. So there are only two economic systems, and it's going to be capitalism or socialism. Capitalism is a backward system. There's no need to discuss it. Certainly anyone who's been made a slave by capitalism ought to be hesitant to try to support the system. But as a conscious African, I must be against capitalism, and I must, of course, seek to destroy it. So when you speak of Pan-Africanism, you must understand you speak of socialism. And we want to underline, there's only one socialism out here, and that's scientific socialism, whose principles are abiding and universal. There's no such thing as African socialism, Chinese socialism, Russian socialism, Arab socialism. There's only one socialism. The confusion arises over ideology. That is that which guides you towards your objective. So we're saying clearly here, Pan-Africanism is not an ideology. It is an objective. It is an achievable. Pan-Africanism is the total liberation and unification of Africa under scientific socialism. All we want is a unified continent with a socialist system. That's all. But you know, Africa is the richest continent in the world. When she's properly organized, she'll be the most powerful. Now, of course, and me, all I want is power. I'm not like others. I don't want money. I don't want popularity. I just want the power I'm supposed to get. That's all. History of the world, and then they react. No, not me. I know the particular history of Europe is not the issue of the world. I know this. I know Africa has made great contributions to humanity, great contributions. Capitalism and socialism are economic systems. They have absolutely nothing to do with Europe. Karl Marx did not invent nor found socialism, even though many people say that. He just discovered it. That's all. He discovered the laws of socialism. He didn't found it. We call in America the laws of gravity, Newton's laws, but Newton cannot invent the body from over 32 feet per second squared. Marx cannot invent that where capital oppresses labor, that labor will rise up and overthrow capital. Marx cannot invent this. As a matter of fact, I would like Professor Asante to go and read Ibn Khaldun, an African in Tunisia in the 12th century, who in his writings used terms like surplus, surplus value, property, right to property. He used all the terms that Karl Marx used, and he wrote in the 12th century, and he was an African. The values of socialism are to be found in communalism, and I'm sure Professor Asante knows that communism lasted longer in Africa than any other continent. Therefore, obviously, those values are there easy for us to bring alive through a socialist system. Socialism and capitalism have nothing to do with Europe, just like air and water has nothing to do with Europe. So Europe will let you think that they invented both air and water, and you might be so.
African person born in America, how do we prepare ourselves mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually for this revolution?
The way we do that is by joining organizations, because revolution must be done through a systematic manner, and organizations must do it. One of our weakest aspects as our people is that we are totally disorganized. We come together in a minute, a million or more people, and then sit down and forget all about it. We have no sustaining power because we have no organizations. therefore, to correct this, each and every one of us has joined an organization. This has been our constant theme. All my life, I belong to organizations. All the great people I know belong to organizations. Malcolm X was so bad that when he left the Nation of Islam, he created two organizations. You have the Muslim Mosque Incorporated, the Organization of African American Unity. Martin Luther King was a bad brother. I knew him, I had a chance to see him. But he had an organization, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Fannie Lou Hamer, bad sister, she has an organization. Asada Shaku, bad sister, she got an organization. Angela Davis, when she left the Communist Party, quickly went to the correspondence. Everyone, and I've always been organizations all my life. Our people do not belong to organizations. They think that they are great, they are supermen, they're greater than Martin Luther King, greater than Malcolm X. But once we get to humble ourselves, we will join organizations. Once we all become organized, freedom will follow just like the sun follows the moon.
Thank you.
One thing, I agree with Brother Ture, except that I would just add one thing. That it seems to me that we are organized. I mean, if you look at all the organizations in the African American community, the so-called not-for-profit organizations, the churches, there's a lot of organizations in the black community. So it's not so much organization that we need, but organization with purpose. See, I think that we have to be careful about just simply saying organization. We need to be in organizations that are clearly defined, their missions are clearly defined, and they have a purpose. Otherwise, we're simply just, we don't have the proper vehicle to get us to where we think we need to get.
To save time, I want to take you to a logical conclusion. Listen to my statement. Bad organization is better than no organization at all. Heard my statement? The fact what you say is not true. Less than 3% of our people belong to organizations. Go anywhere you are among Africans, ask them, which organization belongs to? I don't believe in organizations. Which are they just guys? They're corrupt. They're taking the money. They ain't doing it right. You know Farrakhan ain't serious. You know, all they can do is criticize. They don't belong to organizations. Asking you how many people belong to organizations, you will see. We do not belong to organizations. This is a tragedy. We have more organizations than any other community in America, but less people organized in them. The NAACP has less than 2% of the population. So how can you say we're organized?
Perhaps we have different statistics. It seems to me that the great number of African Americans are in churches. Those are organizations. But they're not the kind of organization that will lead us to where we need to get to. But they're in organizations. Black people are in organizations. And I think that what we really need to talk about...
Sorry, it's very clear. I said organizations struggling to free the people.
But then we agree.
Okay.
I just took your idea of precision. Yes. And I wanted to make sure that
I was precise. I said it before, but I also want to let you know now, through the 1960s, those churches did a hell of a lot of fighting in the South.
That's right.
And produced some awful, powerful preachers like Fred Shuttlewood, C.T. Vivian.
That's true.
If you sensitize yourself, of what good are you to the rest of us? And you can't even sensitize yourself, it must be done in organization. Unless they're organized, we're not doing it. Our party, the All African People's Revolutionary Party, in 1972, told everyone that we're going to make Africans in this country use the word African, and we're not going to do it through the press. We rolled up our sleeves and went to work. They even call themselves African Americans today. Soon they're going to get rid of the Americans. They're going to write home Africans in America. By yourself, it has to be an organized form. I want to let you know now, if you speak of pan-Africanism, you speak of organization, of revolutionary organization, as precise as that which the Vietnamese had when they destroyed American imperialism. I do not have any immediate solutions to our problems. The only solution I have is a constant struggle. Constant struggle. Constant struggle. And this struggle has to be managed with constant political education of the masses of the people. Constant political education of the masses of the people.
Okay. I would like to know, how would you see the masses taking Pan-Africa socialism and placing it in America? Would this goal be accomplished by legislation, economics, force, or a combination?
By any means necessary.
I guess my question just asks for a little more direction.
No, that's the question of the organization you joined. We have a map worked out. Does anybody in our party have any propaganda which talks about improvements in tourism by chance? You have please be sure the doctor sends it. I'm sorry, really, I thought you knew this. I really did. We solved this problem. Of course, it's a real revolutionary service to solve this problem. So it depends. Our party has a solution. If you go to the local mosque here, the minister of the Nation of Islam is here, is he not? Physician, is he here? He left. Where he is, right. If you go to the Nation of Islam and you should visit it, they give you another program. If you go to the NAACP, they give you a program. Your job is to decide which program you think is the correct program to lead us to freedom. And if when you go to Nation of Islam, you find, oh, they just talk a lot of nonsense. You go to AAPRP, they just talk nonsense. You go to NAACP, they talk nonsense. Well, man, you do what is necessary for all of us. You create the organizations that lead us to freedom.
A black man was unjustifiably murdered. That say we get treated differently by some officers who are aggressive from jump.
Topic, we could just begin to show and to demonstrate how, in fact, as a political activist, and of course, this history could be shared for most political activists, how, in fact, I came to, unlike most people in America, begin to see the police apparatus in this country for what it is. Of course, like most people in the United States of America, in my early life, I thought the FBI were these good guys who went around and helped everybody. And I thought that they were supposed to be the guys who supported peace and all this nonsense. As a young man at Howard University, I went to work in the South, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in Mississippi. And here I thought the legal basis for this work was clear. In fact, all we were trying to do as young students was to get our people the right to vote. Of course, while I may have been a little bit confused about the FBI, I was not certain which one to do. This one? While I certainly was aware of the racist and terroristic nature of the United States of America in relationship to Africans, I certainly have not understood the role of the FBI as an organized force of terrorism against my people. This realization would dawn on me through hard and serious struggle. We said the legal basis for our work in the South Square, according to the American Constitution, toilet paper. Here it was stated that every man, every woman had the right to vote. Of course, I know the history of my people in this country. I know
that my people have never arrived at any position in this country, not even individual positions, without the shedding of blood in mass struggle.
Understanding these points, that you could come to see properly the real racist and terroristic nature of the FBI and the CIA. I say I know this, and this is clear, all of us knowing here, no one thing in this room can deny any of the following statements I make. One, for Africans to sit in a lousy 5 and 10 cent store where they want to be, they have to shed their blood. For Africans to ride on a bus, even though they pay the same amount of money as anybody else does, in order to sit where they want to sit, they have to shed their blood. For Africans to live anywhere in this country where they want to live, even if they have the economic capability of doing so, they have to shed their blood. For African students to attend universities just like any other student in this country, their people must shed their blood. In order for us to get the vote, which everybody gets just like that, even the immigrant who can't even speak English coming here, we Africans, in order to get the vote, we must shed our blood. No one sitting in this audience can show me any example of advancement by the African masses in this country, even individual positions of advancement, which have not been acquired at the price of the shedding of the blood of the masses of our people. So if you're not careful, they will let you think that Africans make progress like everybody else, and the way they write up the histories, he was the first doctor in this area, the first student of this university, the first this, and it makes it appear as if this individual who's the first doctor or the first student really worked hard and was special, unlike the rest of the masses of people, and that these qualifications were so much that they had to be granted the position. More lies. No African in this country has arrived at any individual position without the shedding of the blood of the masses of our people. Anytime you see a mayor anywhere in this country, you must know that that mayor arrived at that position only through the shedding of the blood of his people. Anytime you see a student at the University of Delaware, an African student, you must know that student occupies a seat only because of the shedding of the blood of the masses of the people. Of course, the logical conclusion must be clear. Since the people shed the blood for these positions do not belong to the individuals who occupy them. These positions belong only to the masses of the people.
the political conclusions must also be clear. Anytime you use this position, which has been gained by the blood of the people, not for the people, but for yourself, for your own individual interest, you have already betrayed the blood of the people. They will tell you that that man, Kwame Ture, he's just uncompromising when he speaks. Everything is either white or black, hot or cold, wet or dry, that there is no middle ground, there is no gray area when he speaks.
They are absolutely correct. I am a revolutionary and I speak of principles for which I am willing any time at the drop of a hat to shed my blood. And I will never compromise those principles to live, not me. Consequently, when I speak as a revolutionary, I speak of principles. And when one speaks of principles, there is no middle ground. There is no gray area. Everything is hot or cold, wet or dry, black or white. There is no gray area, although some will try to create a gray area or a middle ground where it does not exist. Your students, show me the middle ground on a test. Either you cheat or you do not cheat. Where's the middle ground? You are human beings. Tell me. When you recount a story, either you lie or you tell the truth. Where is the middle ground? You are human beings. You live in a world where people have religious beliefs. Either you believe in God or you do not. Where is the middle ground? And some might say, we'll try to make middle ground. The other day, a sister told me, well, I doubt God, but I still believe in him. Once you start doubting God, you have stopped believing in him. There is no middle ground where principles are concerned. This must be properly understood, especially for you and those who come to want to make a contribution to humanity, and especially to your people who are a part of suffering humanity. It must be clear here then that if your people are oppressed, either you are for the people or you are against the people. There is no middle ground. This must be properly understood. It's everywhere the capitalist system will try to give you illogical reasoning to make you make middle ground. Another day, I was speaking to a brother. I said, my brother, our people are oppressed.
Yeah, brother, finally, right.
I said, our brother, our people are suffering everywhere. Brother, the government pushing drugs in our people, trying to confuse our youth to stop their rising militancy. He's trying to create all cause of confusion. The police themselves are arming youth in our communities to bring gang wars to carry out their drug wars for them.
I said, I know you're right, brother Kwame.
Hit me!
There's not a minute to spare. There's not a minute to spare.
Don't worry.
I said, brother, you have to come and help the people. He said, I can't help them right now.
For some reason.
He said, but brother Kwame, I'm not against the people. I said, you're not. He said, I don't do nothing against them. I'm not working for the FBI. You know, sure, I ain't helping them, but I ain't against them. I said, you're against them. If your people are oppressed, and you are not involved in the struggle to liberate your people, by your very act of inaction, you are against your people. I've understood all my life, because all my life I have been in organization, all my life. So I have organizational discipline, something that the overwhelming majority of the masses of my people lack. They simply lack organizational discipline because they've never belonged to any organization. Of course, organizational discipline is necessary. Its first necessity is to inform the individual that there's something more important than he or she, the organization, and the principles for which it stands. This is necessary in a country like America, where all aspects of individuality is blown completely out of proportion. Where an African will even tell you, work for my people, what do they do for me? They never did nothing for me. Do they pay my bills? I'm out here for me and me alone. Don't nobody help me and I don't need them.
America is a backward country.
Well, it will make you stupid. It makes you arrogant in your stupidity. Here it is, screaming, oh, this is backward. All of us sitting here knows that an individual human being isolated from the human species is totally incapable of making any contribution to life. These are biological facts.
If you take a kitten the minute it's born before it opens its eyes, you take a dog a puppy before it's born, before it opens its eyes when it's born. If you throw both of them in the woods, isolated by themselves, they will go to their fullest animal potential. The dog will walk on all fours, he will bark, as soon as he finds a bone, he will love it. The cat will meow, the cat will chase mice as soon as he finds them. But if you take a child, a human being, the minute he or she is born, without opening their eyes, and put them in their woods, isolated by themselves, if they live, they will never arrive at their fullest human potential. It is questioned whether or not the child will walk. Certainly the child will not talk. And it is clear the child will be able to make no contribution to the society. We push the argument one point further, again sticking clearly within the clade of the logics of the statement. We continue to say that a human being isolated from the human species is more stupid than any other animal isolated from its species. Take the same kitten, take the same puppy, take the same child, as soon as they're born, without their eyes open, throw them to live with monkeys. The dog will walk like a dog, bark like a dog, and love bones. The cat will meow like a cat, walk like a cat, and love mice. The child will walk like a monkey, talk like a monkey, eat monkey food, and try to make a contribution to monkey culture. The statement then is clear, crystal clear, so that we can smash quickly all of these nonsensical ideas of individuality. The individual is dependent upon the masses of the people for everything. Consequently, the individual must subsume themselves to the desires, the struggles, and the aspirations of the masses of the people. This is clear. For the Africans, it is even more clear. We say without the slightest hesitation, any African who rises above the masses of his people have only done so by stepping upon their heads.
As a matter of fact, any man trying to pull himself up above the people is a stupid man. It's only when the people rise that you can rise.
You know, the capitalist system is a racist system. Its job is to inculcate into our minds a racist statement and have us accept these statements without questioning.
Of course, if I were to make the statement today in 1992 that Columbus discovered America in 1492, I am sure there was someone who would say, well, that's not true. He didn't discover it. These people are already here, etc., etc.
But by saying that, it has no effect upon the fact that they do accept the racist statement that Columbus discovered America in 1492.
Let me give you a clear example.
Of course, one of the greatest crimes an individual and certainly a people can commit is to be ungrateful.
Thus, as a people, we must never be ungrateful.
I am willing to bet you that in this room, even though we sit among college students at an institution of higher learning, there are very, very, very few of you, if any of you, that know anything about the United States of America before 1492, or even attempt to find out.
Thus, once they tell you that Columbus discovered America in 1492, even if you say no, but you don't do research before 1492, you've already accepted it by fact and deed. Even if not by word, but we know there's always contradictions in words. If we ask any of you, how many of you love the people? Every hand will go up.
How many of you study the people's history every day since you love them?
Every hand will go down.
But we love our people, Brother Kwame.
I hear you. So we understand clearly these contradictions.
Clearly. Africans in America must know about America before 1492. They have to. It is imposed upon them because of the kindness of the indigenous people in this country.
When we first came to this country as slaves, we could not escape anywhere because of our beautiful black skins. The only place we could find sanctuary in this country was among the indigenous people on the land.
You must not let capitalism give you your history. They cannot give it to you, neither facts nor correct interpretation. They will tell you about Buffalo soldiers. Yes, they were, but that's a minority.
If you look properly at the history here, you will see every time we went to the Indians, they took us in, protected us, and mutually respected us, intermarried with us on a completely basis of mutual respect. Some of us even became chiefs of their tribes. Our party, the All African People's Revolutionary Party, this is 1992, exactly 20 years ago, in 1972, formulated a program entitled Smash the FBI and the CIA. They went to all the left-wing countries, organizations, countries, said, listen, let's join our forces and smash the FBI. Of course, I know, as a political activist, that inside every organization, the FBI is to be found. That's their job, and you must expect it. That's to be expected. That shouldn't make you paranoid or even afraid to travel. On the contrary, your job is to scientifically work so you can continue to work while isolating the FBI agents inside your organization. This is the task. They infiltrate every organization. We say the only way they can be destroyed is through organization. The African masses in this country must be organized. Even if they don't want to destroy the FBI, they must be organized, because it's only through organization that they will advance their struggle. It is clear here. We started off by demonstrating our history in this country. We say, for everything we get in this country, even individual advancement, we must shut our blood. It doesn't make sense to me that to get to 5 or 10 cent store, you shed your blood. To get to school, you shed your blood. To get the vote, you shed your blood. To sit on a bus where you want to, you shed your blood. No. Since we got to shed our blood for everything we get in this country, just for reform, let me run. Understand me properly. We've not been shedding our blood for revolution. We've been shedding our blood for reform. Have you ever heard that? And they call America a democratic country. Me, I have to shed my blood for reform. Usually you shed your blood for revolution. Not for reform. But all we've been making reforms. And just for reforms, we've got to shed our blood. So if you're shedding your blood here, there, isolated for reform, logically it makes sense that we get together, organize ourselves, make revolution, shed our blood one time, and be free. The logic is clear. In our final statements, we must impose upon you the necessity to play a crucial role in your people's struggle. We have said that if your people are oppressed and you're not helping the people, you're against the people. That's a fact. There's no discussion here. The only way you can help your people is by being in an organization. The FBI is a powerful organization. Powerful. But it will be brought down by the righteousness of the organization of the African masses and those who love justice in this country. You must organize. I organize for the All African People's Revolutionary Party. Ours is a revolutionary party. We're against capitalism and we're out to smash the FBI and the CIA. Reform, man, we're gonna do it. We'll smash them. They've got so much trouble today, they can hardly breathe, and we'll give them more trouble. So it is, when you don't know your history, you get confused. But you know, some of us don't even begin, we begin our history in 1619. Don't even go back. Well, I'm an American. No. You can never begin your history in the arms of your enemy. All you'll have is your enemy's rendition of your history. Many people who are enslaved, fighting to be free, cannot begin their struggle in the point of their capture. No, they must go back to when they were free, to give them inspiration, to push them to fight for higher qualified level of freedom. Consequently, any African in America seeking to find the truth about situation must begin the history not in 1619, not on a slave ship, but in Africa. If they don't begin Africa, they are lost from the beginning. They will end up as good slaves.
Is speaking with fire in your belly on African Liberation Day. You will be discussing everything from Zionism being a direct enemy of African people to smashing the FBI and CIA. Brother Kwame, when most of us were talking about voting and mobilizing, you put emphasis on nonstop organizing. Brother Kwame, many of our people don't see the danger of remaining divided. We are so happy you always stress the importance of being united. Brother Kwame, when you encountered many Africans with genuine anger and energy, you always explained to them, without political education, we cannot defeat the enemy. Brother Kwame, many activists from the 1960s talk about how during that period we were full of life but prepared for death. You never bored our people with war stories. You remained on the front line till your very last breath. Brother Kwame, thank you for keeping the vision of Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah and Ahmed Sekou Touré alive. We will continue our struggle for liberation as opposed to just trying to survive. Organize, organize, organize. A tribute to Kwame Ture by Obi Egbuna Jr.